Hey, everybody, welcome back to Autism Confidential, the podcast from the National Council on Severe Autism. I am Jill Escher. I'm the president of NCSA, and I am your host today. And drumroll, please. This is our 50th episode. I can't believe it. Yeah, and this is a really great episode, an awesome episode, because we're going to talk to a really super duper awesome autism mom. But like 50, will we make it to 100? I don't know. Maybe I can say right now, send money. If you want us to make it to 100, support NCSA. Well, actually, we will be starting a fundraising campaign next month. So nice. Yeah, you probably will hear a little bit about that coming up. Perfect. Because we do need the support. So who is my guest today, everybody? If you're on video, you can see this book. It is a brand new book called Girl Storm by Peg Kerswell. And we are here with Peg herself. Say hello.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
Oh, we're so excited. So Girl Storm is a new memoir. It kind of looks like a novel, you know, like, but it's a memoir. This is a memoir of chaos, humor, and resilience in the path of profound autism. This might be the first book that uses the term profound autism.
Yeah.
So you get a special gold star for that. And I just published on ncsautism.org, our website, a review of the book. So I invite all of you listeners to go read that review, which might go into some details that you won't get on the podcast today. But needless to say, it was a very positive review. I felt that the book told an important story and told it very, very well and helps raise awareness of the most severe end of the autism spectrum. Welcome, Peg.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
So Peg, why did you write this book? As we were talking before, you're not a professional writer.
No, not
at all. What got into your crazy head to do something like this?
I think after my daughter was placed, I was trying to make sense of everything that had happened, you know, from infancy to the point when we put in residential placement, and it was so chaotic. It's almost as if I hadn't processed all of it. So at first it was a way to just put it down on paper and sort of figure it out, like what exactly took place? What were the events? Like it was just from one crisis to another. So it started as that. And then I was thinking more about the community and how isolated I feel. And that got me thinking that I'd like to release the book and really put it out for parents like ourselves, who really, I don't know, this is a very challenging experience. I wrote this book because I couldn't find it. I remember going to look for something that was really telling the truth about the experience. Like everything was either like a manual for autism, you know, how to treat it, or, you know, the more milder side, the more positive side. And there are plenty of positive things about autism. But I wasn't seeing, you know, the darker things that I was experiencing. And a book that was really going into detail about the multitude of emotions that come with it. It's not always an easy experience. You know, for me, it's been a lot of grief. It's been a lot of pain. It's been a lot of anger, a lot of confusion. So I feel like I wrote it because there was nothing like this out there. No background in writing whatsoever. I did read a lot of books about writing, and I've read a lot of memoir, and I sort of studied a lot of authors that I really enjoyed and really studied their writing. But that was about it. And in terms of writing it, I would write a little bit of it and then I would put it away because it was kind of draining to write and revisit a lot of the stuff. So I'd write some and then I'd put it away and then I'd bring it out and go, why am I doing this? And then I'd put it away. But you know, it was important to me to finish it and have something completed. So I was able to pull it all together, you know, sometime this summer, and then put it out in September.
And when you started this project and you were trying to sort through all this trauma, as you said, you went from one crisis to another. I'm sure you didn't have 5 seconds to think about your situation while you were immersed in it.
Yes, absolutely.
And then you had time. Your daughter did go into a mm-hmm. residential treatment program, which we'll talk about. Mm-hmm. You finally had this stillness, this quiet in your life, which you hadn't had at all for what, 13 years, 14 years?
Yeah. 14 years, yeah.
And so was your intention always to write it for a broader audience because you didn't see those narratives out there?
I wasn't really thinking, I was focusing mostly just on the severe autism community.
Mm-hmm.
But I was thinking, I was hoping that if anyone outside of the community picked it up, that this would give them some insight as to what our lives can really look like, because I don't think really people know, because they're not seeing our kids out in the community. I know that when I used to try to take my daughter Ellie out of the community, it was really, really, really difficult. She's a disrober, so she would often take all of her clothes off. She mm-hmm. would drop to the ground, smash her head on the concrete of, you know, in the parking lot. She would run. So I wasn't able to take her out very often. So I think a lot of people don't really know what the day-to-day experience can really look like and how intense it is. Mm-hmm. The feedback that I'm getting, some of the feedback I'm getting about the book is that the first chapter is just like, oh my goodness, it's so intense. It's so intense. And the funny thing is that really was just a regular, typical day, you know, it's like that typical day. There was nothing extra going on that day. There was no medical crises. There was no seizures. There was no, anything above and beyond. That was just a regular old day trying to get her ready for school.
Mm-hmm.
So that has really opened my eyes. Like, people really don't know what's happening behind our closed doors, you know?
There have been some other memoirs out there. For example, Amy Lutz, it's not, she didn't really write it. It was more a series of essays on profound autism, as seen through the eyes of her son, Jonah. She wrote a book called We Walk, but not exactly a memoir. And then another one, is called Autism Uncensored. I think that came out.
Okay.
I want to say 5 years ago or something by a mom in Maryland, which, you know, again, just told the brutal truths about the experiences with her son, Zach. And it got a lot of blowback from neurodiversity activists who said, well, you're not allowed to tell these stories. Did you have that in mind? Were you worried about people saying, well, you're not allowed to talk about your daughter without your daughter's permission? You're not allowed to reveal, you know, these difficult moments in her life. Were you concerned about that or no?
I wasn't thinking about that at all because, and I think if I were, the book wouldn't have been authentic.
I agree with that. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just, you know, I love my daughter beyond measure. I would do anything for her. And at the same time, this is a really tough experience. It's not for the faint of heart. So I think if I were thinking about a lot of that stuff, it wouldn't have been a real book, a true book.
You would have been self-censoring the whole time.
Yeah. And it wouldn't have come through as authentic. And people need to know what's happening. If we all just are looking the other way and sweeping this community under the rug, how are we going to get any services? Like, you know, we need a lot more residential facilities, especially for the under 21 community. The waiting list for the facility that Ellie's in is infinite. You know, it's super, super long. People, we know we're incredibly lucky to even have gotten her in there.
Mm-hmm.
I just feel like if no one's telling the truth and really being honest about it, you know, we're not going to get the things that we need.
Certainly that's NCSA's belief, right? Mm-hmm. That we don't betray our children by telling their truth, right? We are supporting and honoring our children by telling their truth, right? Because the world needs to know what they're dealing with and what they need.
And they can't express it. My daughter can't express her truth
mm-hmm.
in any way, shape, or form.
Mm-hmm.
Not in any way. She can't use an iPad. She has no speech. And I tried to be very conscious of that and be respectful as I was, you know, writing the book, I tried to be respectful of her and of the community. I hope it came across that way. But yeah, I just want people to know that they're not alone, because, you know, I've been all over your website, which is amazing. And I think you're a total badass. The numbers are growing. This isn't going away. Mm-hmm. I want the parents coming up, like when I was, terrified, especially in the very beginning, knowing that somebody else is much further along and you can get through it. Is it easy? No. But, you know, you can get through it. And people, and that somebody else out there gets it, really gets it. Mm-hmm. And that it's okay to have all of these conflicting emotions about it, and still love your child and still, you know, want the best for them.
Absolutely. When you talked about, there's a moment in the book where you talk about the fear of losing her, right? And I won't go into detail for her, but, you know, Ellie had various ailments and oh, many emergency room visits.
Yes.
And many medical mysteries.
Yes.
Oh my gosh, the one about the eye, that was amazing. What a story.
I know.
But I completely related to, like, the terror, where on one hand, yes, you are kind of being bludgeoned to death by the needs of your children. At the same time, you can't imagine life without them. I mean,
that
it's
that would crush me.
Yeah. And I just can't imagine. Well, mm-hmm. I have two kids with profound autism, but not as profound as Ellie's, because Ellie is in the ultra category. He's like, we need a special category just for people like her.
She's the best. By the way, I watched your TED talk, which was incredible.
Oh, thank you.
Really enjoyed it. And I saw Sophie.
Oh yeah.
Oh my God. My heart just went, I was like, it's Ellie. Just like the hair and
our
just
little blonde, you know, girls.
I was like, she's beautiful. She's beautiful. And I was just so happy to see her.
Yeah. They're about the same age.
Oh really?
Sophie's 17 now. I don't know.
Ellie's 19.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Close to the same age. Yeah. Yeah. Sophie, but I'm fortunate that I have a profoundly autistic daughter who doesn't have the behaviors.
Gotcha.
You know, people look at me like, how did that happen? And I'm like, that's amazing. I don't know. Cause my son certainly has, you know, quite a history of property destruction and self-injury. So not nearly as bad as Ellie's.
Yes.
So let's tell the reader a little bit about the story here. So we enter, you know, the book, we enter the book with you walking down the stairs very gingerly, because heaven forbid something disturbs sleep, which causes a meltdown, which causes chaos, right?
Yes.
I know we've all been that, walking on eggshells completely, parents. But then we get introduced to her as an infant, and you notice I remember you saying that you felt something was wrong from the very beginning.
Yeah, I did.
What was that? I know you talk about the ears, but what else?
Yes, that was just me being silly, which I am often. I sensed right from the second I saw her, to be honest, she didn't seem to be, there seemed to be something not connecting. So even when the nurses wheeled her in, you know, I had a C-section, and they wheeled her in the next morning. And I remember looking at her and looking into her eyes and not feeling in my gut like there was that connection. Mm. And so immediately I'm thinking, all right, this is postpartum depression, which I did have very intensely, but maybe that was part of the reason that I had it. You know, looking back, all of the signs were there from birth. You know, she was extremely delayed, as I go into detail in the book, you know, didn't walk until she was about 2.5. And that's only with extensive physical therapy. She wasn't tracking, you know, she just didn't seem interested in anything. Like, you know, she did a lot of staring. She was incredibly calm, which now in retrospect seems really silly, you know, because it really changed. But she just seemed like a part of her was somewhere else. Mm-hmm. I think I picked up on that immediately. And in my gut, you know, there was this feeling of panic, and I was like, my husband was always trying to calm me down. And eventually, you know, kept missing the milestones, and then finally brought it to a neurologist, and then the whirlwind began, you know, doctor right. after doctor after doctor, all the testing, which yielded nothing.
Right. And I was, you know, given her extreme severity, you know, the yeah. existence of really extreme intellectual disability, mm-hmm. you know, the seizures,
yes,
maybe even something like her ears. I don't know. You didn't talk about any other kind of dysmorphologies she might have,
yes.
but I suspected that she may have something genetic, but you said no, they didn't find anything.
They didn't. And I was yeah. thinking the same. We were thinking the same, like there's got to be a reason for this. Yeah. Maybe if
but
we
I know
test her now.
Here in the Bay Area, I know yeah. several. They're now young adults with similarly ultra, ultra severe autism.
Okay.
And they don't, there's no diagnosis, you know, genetic diagnosis for them either. So it's not the first time I'd
gotcha.
seen this, but
yeah.
yeah, but I mean, maybe they'll find something eventually, but yeah, it is. It always astonishes me that you can have these kids, kid after kid after kid after kid, with some of the most severe disabilities ever
yes.
seen on this planet.
Yes.
And we're still like, we don't know.
We don't know. Yeah. Yes.
To me, that's just completely unacceptable.
It's amazing. It's yeah. amazing. We had her tested every which way.
Yeah.
Her DNA was studied. Everything. And just nothing came back.
Yeah.
Even with the seizures, with the, you know, there's really nothing else about her physically. That would indicate, you know, like a syndrome or something. So yeah, she's just a mystery.
Yeah.
She's a great big mystery.
So then she's growing up, obviously. She's in therapy a lot.
Yeah.
You talked about, and this is something most of us can relate to, how you had no privacy in your house because you had ABA therapists coming in and out,
yes.
you know, doing their therapy, taking data, and then, you know, she goes to school, but you know, let's be honest, she doesn't really make progress.
Yeah.
You're like just toilet training,
yes,
just if I can get her
I
out
want.
Of diapers,
mm-hmm.
right? Because that
mm-hmm.
was such a hardship on top of everything else.
Yes.
I couldn't even do that.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, and I know that you looked for more help.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell our listeners a little bit about this experience of dealing with this level of severity and just not finding the help you need and finding that the existing help wasn't really delivering.
Yeah. Well, if you can imagine being absolutely desperate for respite, desperately seeking respite, as we say, I would go on to care.com, which mm-hmm. it's a joke, you know, and be like, how do I write this so someone will come help, not be completely, you know, terrified when I walk through the door. But they'll also be somewhat qualified to work with Ellie to help her, to give us some respite. It was quite a predicament. And we did eventually find someone who became almost family to us. I named her in the book, Adriana. Yep. She and her family, and she would bring her kids, and she was a godsend to us, truly. But beyond Adriana, the help was slim. And we needed it desperately. And that's one thing, you know, that I think is important about telling our stories, is that we need qualified respite workers who are paid well. And this is not a job where you can ask just a regular babysitter around the corner to come help.
They had less, you know, 2 seconds. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. If Ellie has a seizure, what are they going to do? If, you know, they need to change a teenage diaper, are they up for that? You know, it's a lot to ask of another human being. So finding help was nearly impossible at times. So it was usually just Jim and myself tag teaming. You know, we would take shifts.
Mm-hmm.
I would watch it. She has to be watched literally every second. Like she has no understanding of danger or anything like that. So yeah, we would take shifts, and you know, I'd be like, okay, I have the next 2 hours, and then you get the 2 hours after that, and we would just do that day after day after day.
Yeah, and how that actually just wore down on your meager reserves of
yes,
energy
exactly.
and hope.
Yep.
And you know, any kind of positive feeling you had about life.
Yes.
You know, it was very clear that it was just an endless, perpetual, you know, grind without any light at the end of the tunnel.
Yes.
Now, speaking of no light at the end of the tunnel, we have to talk about the fact your book is very funny, and that's what makes it stand out. And I tried to convey this in the review that I wrote. And I just barely touched on, you know, the very inventive parts of the book. But one thing you do is you have your own vocabulary.
Yes.
Yes. You know, your situation is so extraordinary. It does require its own language.
Yes,
right?
Like, exactly. Well said.
Like, yeah.
That's how it felt. It really felt that way because I really felt as if we were living in our own little cocooned universe that you would only understand if you experienced it. So I just, for fun, came up with these silly, you know, definitions. But I think a lot of special needs parents will be able to relate to them, whether you have a severely autistic child or not. Just like in speaking with a lot of my friends, you know, I have a close circle of friends, special mom friends.
And you had a name. I'm sorry. What was the name for your?
Oh, the Spun.
The Spun.
Spun. Special Parent Underground Network. And we call ourselves the Spunsters. yeah. And, you know, my daughter has autism. A bunch of them, their kids have cerebral palsy, but more on the severe end. So they really very much related to my silly dictionary and to the book as well. The vocabulary is just my silly way of coping. Because, you know, at certain points during the time when she was home, it just, some of the things that were happening were just so ridiculous that, and they're never funny in the moment, but they're always funny, you know, a month or two later.
Right.
So, and that's really how my husband and I have coped, you know, a lot of laughter, and just being silly, not trying to understand why everything's happening, just going with the flow as best as we can.
So throughout the book, I guess kind of before every chapter, I think there's a little list or a little poem or a little chart.
Yes.
And, you know, I just love this part. Like, here, I don't know if people can see this.
Yes, the ERV chart. Yes.
Do you want, so maybe explain this one. Maybe we'll go
through that one. Sure. Estimated respite value chart. so silly. But it's true. It's actually true. Like, those are some real measurements from our experience.
Can I give some examples?
Of course.
Okay. The estimated respite value chart. Stimable, magazine with thick, glossy pages. ERV, 30 minutes.
it has to be thick, glossy pages.
In my world, it would have been like 2 minutes. Baby board book, 20 minutes. Tough to rip, but apparently some people can do it. And I love that scene in your book. We go to the bookstore to get, you know, to get bargain bin books. Because your kid's going to read the book, but because your kid likes flipping it and ripping it to shreds.
Those were ripper bowls. Yep. Yep.
Again,
very strange.
I did that exact same thing.
Oh, good. Good.
Oh yeah. For Johnny, not so much for Sophie. Let's see. Sand, 1 hour minus cleanup time, washing out of hair and body crevices. plastic connecty thingies flicked around in a bin, 40 minutes, but requires high oral tolerance. Pile of leaves. That's her real love.
Yes.
1 hour.
Loves leaves.
Yes. And then look at the cover. We see
she's still obsessed with leaves.
With loves leaves. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Estimate respite value. I love that. I'm like, because when you're like, I just need to make dinner. I just need to take a shower. Yep. I just need to make a call. I just need to pay bills. Yeah, you'll do anything for that respite
Absolutely.
Value.
Absolutely.
Yeah. One thing I should say is one reason I kind of have a semblance of a life now is my son no longer lives with us. So he lives nearby. He has his own house with staff. I visit every single day.
Okay.
I'm very much part of his life.
That's
but
wonderful.
I don't have that
The code red. Yeah,
yes, just the code red.
The adrenaline rushing 24/7. Yeah, there's nothing like it. There's nothing like that.
All right, I have to show you this one too. This is favorite. Fun and games. The acronym search.
Yes. And you know, you can actually do it.
I haven't done it yet, but yeah.
I've done it.
FOIA, IDEA, IEP, PDD, PECS, SIB, SLB, ABA, AAC, ASL, DSM.
They're all in there. It's just funny. You know, I felt the need to interject some humor like through it, because I know it's kind of a heavy read.
Yeah.
So I just had to lighten it up. And, you know, again, that's how my husband and I have been coping. Just, you have to be silly at some point. Otherwise, it's just too intense.
Yeah. I mean, you look at our kids, look at their lives.
Yeah.
And yeah, if you can't laugh about it, you know, you do go to very dark places. And
yes.
By the way, in the book, you do go to dark places.
I do.
Yeah. And I will tell you this. Every parent of a severely autistic kid has gone to dark places, you know, and I think that when they see that in the book, they will appreciate knowing, you know, they're not alone.
They're not alone. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think it's just perfectly normal. It's perfectly natural. I mean, anybody who lives with that level of stress and trauma constantly, mm-hmm. I think that you have one of the lists in here. Here it is. Here's the list. Okay. This is a poem called Before. Okay. And it goes to this exact point. And you say, before I untangle myself from a dream, before I can empty my bladder, before I can figure out what day of the week it is, before I take a sip of coffee, before I remember to take my own meds, before I can digest what I ate the night before, it goes on and on.
Yep.
And then you say, it's already starting again.
Yep.
In other words, it's just the cycle,
There's no relentless break.
Sisyphean cycle. Yeah. Yep. No break.
Absolutely.
Okay. Yeah. So now let's jump a little bit, fast forward. You are in, you know, the depths of autism hell. Mm-hmm. And then you find from the disability cloud, the wormhole. The disability cloud is another great term. It's like, it's amorphous, like disability stuff that's out there that
we're not allowed to see it. I don't even know what my daughter's file says. I don't know.
Exactly.
So it's just very silly.
Yeah, so my kids are also in the disability cloud, but then you got into the wormhole to finally, after all these years of begging and pleading and pleading and begging, mm-hmm. you find a residential program in New Jersey, your state. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
It was very difficult to squeeze through that wormhole. There were a lot of hoops. Like I write in the book, the first application was denied. I think it was, and I mentioned this in the book, because of the doctor's format. They didn't like the format that he had written his evaluation in.
Oh,
yes.
That was, I couldn't believe, actually I could believe it.
No, it was true. It was true. But it was very difficult to get a place. I mean, all of the list of criteria that I had to go through to all the evaluations, the testing that I had to do just to be considered. Then I submitted the application, it was rejected. And then I was like, oh my God, well now what? So then I had to find another doctor to write a new evaluation, which took several weeks. Lots of begging doctors to write evaluations. Finally she was accepted, which felt like a miracle. It felt like an absolute miracle. And we felt so incredibly lucky. And we are very, very lucky. And then she was added to a wait list. And, you know, we didn't have to be on the wait list super long. A spot opened up relatively quickly for her, which is somewhat rare. So within a few months of her being on the wait list, she was, we took her to the facility. And I'll never forget dropping her off and just coming upon that building and just feeling so much hope for her, for us, and for humanity. I know there's still...
It was the first time there was real hope in the whole book.
Was it? Okay. That's how I felt. That's truly how I felt. And, you know, it's, I still feel that way. I feel like this place saved our lives, hers as well. And I wish, you know, so many people are on that waiting list now. And, you know, when you talk about the severe end, Ellie's very, very, very severe, but she's tiny.
Mm-hmm.
At the facility where she goes, you know, I'll see big boys who are that same level of severity. And there are parents right now, as we do this podcast, with these boys in their home, and, you know, they're worried about being hurt by their own children because mm-hmm. they're, because of the severity of disability. I'm thinking about those folks all the time. But the facility really has restored my faith in humanity. Like, I remember pulling up and just being like, I can't believe that human beings have created such a place. And
could
I know
you share the name of the facility, or are you
sure? Sure. It's called Bancroft. Okay. Yeah, it's called Bancroft. Ellie started in Bancroft at another part of Bancroft called the Linden Center, which is for the most intensely behavioral children.
Mm-hmm.
So she started there.
And this is a private nonprofit that contracts with the state of New Jersey. Is that?
I don't believe it's private.
Is it a state run facility?
It's a state facility, I believe. Don't
okay.
quote me on that. Yes, I know it's Medicaid funded.
Mm-hmm.
It was, you know, there's still such a stigma, I think, with placing your child. And that's another reason that I wanted this book to be out there, because, you know, I feel like a lot of us are being judged for not having our children live with us. And I want people to know that sometimes that's just not an option.
That's
really
not an option.
Just yeah. not an option for her yeah. or for us. My daughter needs a staff of people. She requires a staff of people to take care of her.
Yeah.
But she's making nice progress. She's made a lot of progress since she's been there. She was on lithium when they first accepted her. And honestly, I didn't think she was going to improve at all. Mm-hmm. She was banging her head.
So it's a mix of psychiatric treatment. It's the all hands on
yes.
deck, right? So they have psychiatric
Absolutely.
Treatment, behavioral
and
treatment, and medical treatment, which is the way it should be for
yes.
all these kids. I mean,
yes.
that should be the comprehensive wraparound approach
yes.
that you need, right?
Yes.
That's why
yes.
I wrote in my review, it's like, what the F is she doing in school? Like,
yeah.
this is, that's not the answer
right.
for a kid like Ellie. You need to have
right.
this wraparound program.
Right.
There's so many kids who need that. And
yes.
you know, the parents are like, they can't even get a single appointment sometimes with
yes.
any one of these specialists.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. This should be a given. But yeah, so they changed their her meds. Like what,
yeah.
tell me what they changed up.
They eventually, the headbanging just kind of slowed down. I don't know if that's something that your son engaged in, but boy, is that a hard thing to see your child banging their head on concrete, on granite countertop.
What
I
is
really
it, 800 times a day at school, right?
That
and
was
one
the
of
hitting.
The data?
Yeah, that was the hitting yourself in the head,
yeah.
and it was like full on punching.
Unbelievable. I can't imagine
yeah.
the trauma to her brain.
Yes. Yeah.
yeah.
So once you got to the Linden Center, it just took time. I think the fact that they had the round the clock care, they had the medical staff, they have 24/7 medical staff there in case she had a seizure. Like, I felt really good about leaving her there. Like, she was in really good hands. There are cameras everywhere monitoring, which I love.
Yeah.
So eventually, you know, with all of the treatments and the ABA and the therapies and the medication, she just started to kind of calm down a little bit. And eventually,
was there a particular medication, I'm curious, that seemed to help? Do you know?
Well, the lithium really did. Even on the lithium, she was still self-injuring to an unbelievable
mm-hmm.
degree. But
mm-hmm.
without it, I think she would have probably killed herself.
Hmm.
Just by hitting her heads, you know, concussing herself. But the lithium, I think, really did help take it down a notch. But it was still very intense. I don't think there was any kind of med change other than, I think it was just having that staff around her all the time and the care. I don't know. Like, she eventually just kind of calmed down, and then calmed down some more, to the point where they were able to move her from the Linden Center to the main campus. So she progressed enough where they could take her out of this super extreme area to a lesser restrictive setting. And since then, you know, she was on the campus for about a year. She progressed enough, calmed down enough so that they could move her into a group home, which is where she is now, an off-campus group home.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so that's a huge amount of progress for Ellie, huge. And now, these days, she will self-injure if she's really, really, you know, angry, frustrated. She will be aggressive if, you know, you try to dress her and she's not in the mood for it, she'll headbutt. But overall, she's a different kid than she was than we dropped off at the Linden Center, you know, years and years ago.
I wish every family had access to this kind of comprehensive approach. Mm-hmm. It really should be, you know, just an entitlement. You know, if you have a kid with profound autism, you know, I hopefully it would save everybody, you know, money and healthcare costs in the long run, right? To do it, you know, when they're younger. Mm-hmm. But so now she's basically in a residential home that's maybe less medical in orientation. Mm-hmm. Is the plan to keep, she's still young, you know, she's 19, to keep her there for a certain amount of time? And
yes,
you know what's going to happen next?
The plan we have right now is for her to stay until she's 21, we hope. Mm-hmm. And then for her to hopefully move up to our area. It's a 2-hour drive each way for us to see her, which makes things really difficult. We want to get her back up here to Bergen County where we live, and be able to see her in a group home up here daily. We would love that. Mm-hmm. We do kick around the idea of possibly bringing her home with a support staff, but I just don't know if that's feasible. It depends on how she does in the next few years. Mm-hmm. I mean, we would love that, but I'm not sure that's realistic.
So the plan, and that's right, what now, I always said about my son. I was like, oh, you know, yeah, he'll live here forever with me, but then it became so dangerous.
Yep.
That
we
had absolutely, once we got to the point where there was no choice,
yes,
we had to move him out. Now, you know, might he move back someday? Maybe, like, if we built a separate kind of unit, but for him and his sister to live together was an absolute shit show.
I'm sure that
can't happen easily. So I know what you mean. I know, like, when you're like, I don't want to move my son out, but then it was we were out of life or death.
Yes, absolutely.
Wow. So what advice do you have for parents who maybe want to tell their stories? You know, like, I hope that this book gets a lot of traction even beyond our little realm of severe autism parents. I hope that, you know, all those people on the outside, all the tippies on the outside will read it. And I hope it, you know, establishes you as a writer who might return to the subject again. But I don't know, what advice do you have? I mean, even I want to write a book. You know, what do you say to autism parents?
There are a lot of us out in the community who are waiting for these stories. Waiting for that validation, waiting to feel, not to feel guilty if you're grieving some things about the experience, if you're feeling angry, if you reach the point where things are so intense and you've been hit so many times that your survival instincts are kicking in and you're thinking of hitting back, those are all normal reactions given the circumstances, and they're okay. I'm not saying it's okay to hit your child. I'm saying, you know, it can happen. You can reach that point where you're just not thinking rationally anymore because you've been at that code red mm-hmm. adrenaline state for so many years. You really start to lose it. Mm-hmm. I know I've been there many times.
Well, you would never have been able to write this book if Ellie was still living with you.
Oh, no.
So I think for a lot of autism parents who would want to tell their story, they're like, I don't know, 5 minutes in the day.
They don't. Yeah. Yes. That's very true. You need a lot of space to write it. And Ellie requires 24/7 monitoring, care, everything. Mm-hmm. There's no time for anything else.
Yeah.
But I would just encourage anyone to be honest, just, and that it's okay to be honest. Because the world needs to hear about it. You know, it's not a bad thing. It's the truth. It's, you know, we all love our children. It's a very complicated situation. It's not going to be cut and dry. It's not all going to be sunshine and kittens, you know, it's very complex. And it's okay to experience the gamut of emotions that comes with it. That's what I would say.
And definitely, you know, tell the truth.
Tell the truth.
Tell the truth. And that's what comes through so strongly, you know, in your narrative.
Right.
Which is, this is coming from your heart, you know.
Yes.
You're not trying. As I said, like, it's not touched by ideology or philosophies mm-hmm. or metaphysics. It's all about what you experienced with your own eyes and body.
Try to.
So do you have any plans for promoting the book to make sure, you know, it gets out there in the world?
Plans. No. Do you have any plans? Just little tiny plans right now. Possibly maybe meeting with some or interviewing with some reporters. I'm running some Amazon ads. Maybe going to some bookstores. That's the extent of my plan at the moment.
There's a bookstore in Maplewood, New Jersey called Words. Yeah.
Yes. That's
you've already connected. Oh, yeah. That's right. You connected with them. With the great Jonah.
Yeah.
That would be a great place to do a reading. Well, I certainly hope that you can, take it on the road and tell your story. To a world that needs to hear it, and to a world that has become, I think, increasingly numb to the realities of autism, and also, I think, increasingly fooled about the realities of autism. Yeah. So, you know, your book is, I think, an important, you know, piece in this this need to push reality onto the stage. So, I really appreciate that. Any closing words for your future readers who are listening?
Future readers.
To this? It was affordable and it's paperback.
Yes.
So $14.99. You don't have to spend like $40 on a hardback.
There is no hardback version.
It's 288 pages. I read it mm-hmm. in about 6 hours, even with lots of annotation.
Wow.
Awesome. Very doable book. And it was hard to put down, I have to say. Oh, I'm the kind of person who's like, I start a book and I'll put it down for like five months.
Me too. Yes, I'm the same.
But this one, it was like, boom.
Yeah. I just want people to know that I get it. Anyone who's reading it in the same boat, I get it. I get it. And I get you. And I get the experience. I just want to say that I'm not like sitting like this to be like casual. I'm pushing my earbud in.
Not your earbud.
I just look like a jerk. I'm like, oh. So, just that I get it and you're not alone. You're not alone. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much, Peg. It was so, so, so nice to semi-meet you via Zoom. And I really appreciate your sharing the story. I will make sure to put the link to the book in the show notes and also a link to my review. If you have anything else you want to share in the show notes, just shoot them over to me. But happy 50th episode to Autism Confidential.
Happy 50th. Wow.
And happy Thanksgiving to everybody, because I think this episode's going to come out a couple days before Thanksgiving. We probably will take a little break after Thanksgiving because I have just too much going on for about 2 or 3 weeks, but hopefully there will be a 51st 51st episode soon. Okay. Peg,
awesome.
Thank you so much. Congratulations on a remarkable achievement.
Thank you.
All right. Signing off.